It's a good day for those of us who believe in equality, love, and justice for all. And I am proud that Wayne Law is here today to host this important discussion about how the Supreme Court rulings this morning apply to Michigan. Wayne Law was proud to host oral arguments in a very important federal case in March, in which Judge Friedman presided and heard arguments challenging the constitutionality on Michigan's ban on gay marriage. And after that series of oral arguments, Judge Friedman found, in his words, the arguments compelling against the law, against the ban, but said he would wait until hearing from the United States Supreme Court before issuing any further announcements or decisions involving the case. Today we're here to comment on the Supreme Court opinions and specifically how they relate to Michigan's ban on same-sex marriage. We have Professor Bob Sedler, distinguished professor and a national expert on the United States Constitution, who served as a consultant to plaintiffs in the Michigan case. And we also have, following him, Carol Stanyards. Carol is co-counsel, along with Dana Nessel, to the plaintiffs in the case, the parents and the three children, and she'll be here to talk about the Michigan case specifically. Following Carol, we'll have the plaintiffs in the case, April DeBeer and Jane Rouse, both mothers of wonderful children. April is a neonatal intensive care nurse, and Jane is an ER nurse, in addition to being mothers and plaintiffs in this case.
I want to comment briefly on the two cases. The first one's from California, is of no real interest to us. The court decided that on procedural grounds. They said that once the Attorney General and the Governor said we won't appeal a decision striking down Prop 8, proponents of Prop 8 will permit it to intervene. Supreme Court said they don't have standing. That's a technical legal term. I'll comment on that, not to you, but to my students. Don't worry about it. In any event, the effect of the denial of standing is to allow the decision of the district court to stand, which means that same-sex marriage is now legal in California. The important case is the DOMA case. It's the Federal Defense of Marriage Act, which goes back to 1996. It denies all federal benefits to same-sex couples. Ms. Windsor, had she been married to her partner, would have saved over $300,000 in federal estate tax. Their marriage was recognized in New York. DOMA prevented them from marrying it. Once the Obama administration took over, it said, we won't defend the case anymore. We think DOMA is unconstitutional, but we want a federal court to say so. A committee of the House of Representatives defended it. Now, the Supreme Court said they had standing. I'm not going to try to explain the difference. It's not relevant to you. But once the court had standing, once they said they had standing, Justice Anthony Kennedy wrote the decision of the court in a 5-4 decision. Justice Kennedy wrote the decision of the court in a 1996 case striking down a Colorado state constitutional provision that refused to include sexual orientation in anti-discrimination laws. He wrote the court's opinion in the 2003 case of Lawrence versus Texas, which said that Texas could not prohibit consensual sex among same-sex couples. After that opinion came down, I wrote an article in the Wayne Law Review saying, 2004, there's no valid reason for banning same-sex marriage and the court should strike it down. Now, these bans, it moved closer to that in the DOMA case because Congress could not give any good reason for denying same-sex couples who were married in, say, Massachusetts, the same benefits as it gave to opposite-sex couples. You know, one of the points that Justice Kennedy made is that the states have authority over marriage. But he said, state laws defining and regulating marriage must respect the constitutional rights of persons. He cited Loving versus Virginia, a 1967 case, where the court struck down a ban on same-sex marriage. And Justice Kennedy says that the Constitution's guarantee of equality, and that's what this is all about, means that at the very least, a bare congressional desire to harm a particular unpopular group cannot justify disparate treatment of the group. Does that seem familiar? And there simply was no justification for discriminating. And that's what this case is all about, discrimination. So Carol will explain to you the arguments that the lawyers have advanced in Michigan's, in the challenge to Michigan's ban on same-sex marriage. Obviously, I'm involved in that strong view. But I think even any outside observer would have to say that today's decision in the DOMA case provides strong support for the claim that Michigan's ban on same-sex marriage violates equal protection. Carol, let me turn it over to you.
Our case was originally brought as a challenge to the second parent adoption statute. Once that case was filed, Judge Friedman invited us to amend our pleadings to add a challenge to the Michigan marriage ban. We raised, like the DOMA plaintiffs, we raised equal protection arguments, and we argued both that our Michigan's ban had no rational basis, and we also argued for a higher level of scrutiny. And the state made various rationales as to why they thought that Michigan's ban was rational. In terms of the Windsor decision, I think this is very good news for our case. It's very good news for our plaintiffs. There is a clear way forward for our case and our claim. Judge Friedman said at the oral argument that he was looking for guidance from the United States Supreme Court, and I believe that although they haven't answered all the questions, they have given him a lot of guidance. The court did not find the broad right that some had hoped. The court did not find yet a right to marry by all people. But I think they saved that for another day. The majority did find that these laws deprive gay and lesbian people of equal protection. That's the most significant ruling for our case. And the court talked in real terms about what that means, what these deprivations actually mean for gay and lesbian people and their families. And for our case in particular, there's some language here that I think is most significant. Talking about DOMA, which again, in a lot of ways, is very much like our case. The statute humiliates tens of thousands of children now being raised by same-sex couples. The law in question makes it even more difficult for the children to understand the integrity and closeness of their own family and its concord with other families in their community and in their daily lives. The court, the majority also wrote that DOMA also brings financial harm to children of same-sex couples. It raises the cost of health care for families by taxing health care benefits, and it denies or reduces benefits allowed to families upon the loss of a spouse or parent. And the court goes on and on and talks about the different deprivations, which is also true in our case. We find it very reassuring that the five justices who authored that language, the five justices who reached that decision, may someday be deciding Michigan's ban on same-sex marriage. In terms of, Windsor did make the point about federalism. That was only one basis. As Bob indicated, the court talked a lot about equal protection and about discrimination, so this was not just a federalism decision in which the court wanted to leave these decisions to the state courts. And most significantly, as Bob has pointed out, the court finds in Windsor that states' rights must respect the constitutional rights of persons, and that certainly applies to our case and to any same-sex marriage case.
We're still trying to understand everything that has come down and trying to understand how it affects us. It looks positive to our case, and as we've always said, this isn't a case about our marriage. This is a case about our children and the civil rights of our children. And we're hoping that Judge Friedman has received the answers that he needs and the guidance that he needs to overturn this so that our children have the same rights as everybody else.
Jane Rouse, R-O-W-S-E. concurring with April, you know, it has always been about our kids and our kids' rights. It is still about that, first and foremost. The Marriage Act is a bonus. We will, as Carol indicated, pursue this as far as we can. And if it ends up in the Supreme Court, it does. We're optimistic that Judge Friedman does have what he needs to rule in our favor. We feel he is a very fair man, and we'll take all this into consideration.
When I met April and Jane a couple years ago, they came to me wanting to do what every couple, every family wants to do. They wanted to protect their children. And this case came about as a way to attempt to do that, recognizing all the many horrible obstacles that the families of same-sex couples face in the state of Michigan. And I can say on this date, I could not be happier that we decided to go forward with this case, that April and Jane had the courage and bravery to move forward with this case. I'm hopeful that perhaps for the first time in 2 years, Carol won't be screaming and yelling about me having dragged her into this case, because she's such a marvelous attorney, and I knew there was no way possible for us to proceed on this without her talent. And for me personally, I could not be more excited. It could not be more thrilling for me than to have my hero, my constitutional law hero, Bob Sedler, to have agreed to advise us on this case. It's just been tremendous for us, and we are so looking forward to a decision in this case by Judge Friedman, which we're very hopeful about, and for pursuing it for as far up as it has to go. And if this case ends up being the case to go to the United States Supreme Court, in which all 50 states are determined to have the right for same-sex couples to marry, then so be it. We have over 30 states in the country that still have constitutional bans, just like Michigan's, perhaps not as draconian as Michigan's, but same-sex marriage bans nonetheless. We think our case would be a tremendous case to go before the United States Supreme Court. We would love to have that opportunity, but in the meantime, we're very excited in anticipating the decision by Judge Friedman.
I think it's been a challenge. You know, going to the grocery store is not normal anymore. There are people even now that still recognize us, you know, months after we've been on camera. I think we did the right thing. We are trying to protect our children, and we've gotten mainly positive feedback. Actually haven't had any issues whatsoever with the public. But I think that's because, you know, we are doing this for our children, and I think as the information about the case came down the line, you know, it took a few minutes for me to understand what they were saying. Not really good on the law, so. But once I realized what they were saying, it kind of gave me a little bit of a relief that maybe, you know, we might be seeing the beginning of the end of this case, and that our children will finally get rights.
And the fact that the court mentioned children specifically and the impact on them, how did that make you feel when you heard that portion of the decision?
I think that was the best part for us, was they did see that, especially on our behalf, that our kids are the most important thing, and that coverage for them was, as Dana indicated, why we contacted her was to try to protect our kids and their futures if something were to happen to one of us. And for them to specifically target the kids made me see that they did see the whole picture and not just, you know, the gay and lesbians who don't have kids. But there are thousands of gay and lesbian couples who do have children, and the effect on that and the kids trickles down, absolutely.
So they really got it.
I believe they really did get it, that they did take everyone into consideration, and not just, you know, the people who want to marry, but the true families that are out there.
Thank you.
What kind of support have you been getting from community, from your immediate community and others who see and recognize?
From our community, we've been getting a lot of positive support. We get so many people who say, you know, thank you for doing this, thank you for standing up for our families, for speaking for us. There are people who want to, but, you know, they're afraid. They're afraid to come out, fear of losing their jobs, fear of losing their kids. As she indicated, we get stopped all the time. We were just out of state, and a high school girl said, I just wrote a story about you guys. And she was just like, I can't believe I'm meeting you. And we were just flabbergasted that, you know, this high school kid was writing about gay marriage and wandered across our story. But we do, we're humbled that people think that we're doing something heroic when, you know, we really think we're just standing up for our kids.
Where to from here?
I'm sorry?
Where to from here?
I think that's the, up to...
The journey of, yeah.
I think that's up to
the journey
Judge
is
Freeman.
There. Yeah. Whatever Judge Freeman guides us to, I believe.
Maybe you can touch on that too. Okay. Kara, maybe you can touch on, you know, where we go from here. I mean, you said that at this point there has been somewhat of a clear road set forth by this ruling, but obviously there's going to be challenges along the way.
There are. So what happens next is that Judge Friedman said that fairly quickly after this opinion came down that he would go ahead and issue his ruling on the marriage ban. I think he's putting on hold for the time being the second parent adoption challenge. And at that point, if we prevail, it's likely that the governor will appeal. If we don't prevail, then we will appeal. So either way, there is likely going to be an appeal in this case.
Dan and April, what will you tell your children this evening?
I think our children are a little bit too young to understand.
Yeah.
But I think basically that, that we love them and, we hope when they're old enough and they do understand that they're proud of what we've done for them.